Okay, this is very grateful. And I was asking last night AR whether we're not signed responsible for this. No? Sa Philippine government, Cosmos, wala pa siguro. But siguro nila will do it, all that stuff. No? But anybody from nila here?
Excellent.
But see, it's 70 goals, there are 169 sub-goals, there are 59 elements of... and it's a very sprawling kind of a goal, right? So that, remember I made a point earlier that this can be used to pick an ambitious government, and a government that wants to change the structure of its relationship with the rest of the world, can use this to try to undertake investments in the industry and all that stuff that will allow it to be developed. Can I have the next slide, please? But at the same time, in part, it was sort of finalized. Like, this is our promise, right? And it's probably the work of the Climate Change Commission.
That's very bold.
You were not informed. Anyway, one thing to say is that this is a very...
70%.
It promises 70% reduction in emission versus business as usual. Right? You should see the other countries, including the United States. Because the United States, just 2 weeks ago, you know, in Paris, I'm sure you were in Paris, the negotiations were so difficult because everybody was contorting themselves so that it would not have to be a treaty that any U.S. government had to bring up through the U.S. Congress. So it was all of the commitments that Obama managed to put together in an executive order. And the judicial system in the U.S. just 2 weeks ago said, This is Obama doing more than what he has executive power for. So actually, first of all, they weakened the climate. They weakened the climate regime because of the U.S. just trying to accommodate the U.S. But the U.S. itself cannot do what Obama actually promised to the negotiating team. So what does it leave us now? It leaves us with whatever it is. But the other thing here is one thing to praise about this document is it is consistent with the 1992 idea that we will undertake these commitments subject to being provided the resources that we need. So, ngayon, yung mga kaibigan ko sa foreign affairs, sometimes what can you like it? No, you know how foreign affairs can keep us up there. Sometimes they deal with other diplomats about their stuff and whatever. Paras ko bakit meron pang escape route na we will undertake the commitments only if we get the resources. But this is the proper way to, this is the proper shape that it should be, right? And I have to explain to them, no? Like in Basel, Vienna, this is the proper shape of that is consistently a feasible international climate change regime. A feasible international climate change regime cannot impose the same responsibilities on everybody because not everybody has the same capabilities to do their part in the climate change effort. Anyway, so can I have the next slide, please? We've got to watch time. Marami yung slides, kanya, maybe some of them will just go quickly. So what is at stake is the space for development. I gave you the calculations for China in an earlier one. Right? If China does not change the technology, it can only go up to $13,000 per capita. What is the per capita income now of the United States? Something like $42,000. The per capita income of Singapore is also something about that. So, if that's the maximum that China will do. But China is actually doing, and it's doing it very smartly. It's time to change the coefficient by changing the way the source of its energy and actually undertaking a lot of technological development. They have become quite international players in wind turbine, you know, and in especially in photovoltaic. in solar panels. Ano yung nangyari po nga ngayon? The Europeans, they're imposing tariffs on Chinese exports of solar panels. They're so efficient now that they're imposing tariffs on solar panels. Kasi the Europeans also want to develop the technology. So you can see, it's a very good example of how a climate change technology is an arena for competition, over controls a particular technology. It is the most advanced kind of technology that any country might want to offer. That they don't want airplanes and all of that. Climate change is a very important technology. And this one is Alex Van Gaal's Alex Van Gaal's obligations of emission reduction. If they do not fulfill their obligations, other countries might be forced to undertake deeper cuts than they have to, and therefore sacrifice their development. Ang kwalito is that, I think I'm talking with people here who are not just economists. The problem is saying this to economists. At the end of the day, a lot of these climate change issues will become a security issue, right? Because it will cause damage and other stuff. So it will become an issue that will be militarized on the part of the big countries, right? And also, maraming dito mga other aspects like yung mga movements of people, right? Migration and all that stuff. So it becomes a security issue, right? So if climate change worsens and worsens, those countries with the biggest military, right, the biggest military capability, the biggest capability to impose the security will on other countries, will be able to protect themselves. Impose on other countries a kind of a and then here, when with the, basically, this is not operational right now, you know, there are all kinds of promises involved. Financing and technology, even in the Paris one doesn't help operational finance and technology element in the Paris Agreement, right? The leading engineering discussions in the Green Climate Fund, in which there's already a board, there's a promise of $10 billion as the Green GDP, though I think only $3 billion has to pay, I don't remember. And therefore there's very little money that is available. But the important thing is to set up the institutions where we can apply for funding if you want to meet our obligation for the grant. Can you have the next time? I'm taking too long, okay, so this is aware about the SDGs, and I make the argument here that unless you industrialize, you will be unable to solve your employment and economic growth and infrastructure development But here when I say industrialization, it includes agricultural development. Actually, that's a very important climate change issue. Agriculture is one of the biggest polluters and one of the biggest victims of climate change. The number that we had it in our volume was like 70% of the pollution emissions come from from agriculture, right? But of course, agriculture itself will become a victim of climate change. I remember when the Myanmar people are very worried that you see coming the salt water coming into their land will reduce their, because Burma is always like water, right? When the salt water comes in, if they cannot put enough dikes, their productivity in producing rice will actually decline. It's things like that. Can I have the next slide? So, therefore, if you want to do sustainable, it's very important to be able to increase your rate of investment. We can talk. I know, mas mas interesting yung second topic, you know, parang warm up akito, pero I used to be the warm-up actor for many months, so then we used to. Very much. Sabi niyo, hindi ko magiging lahat ng nasa dahil ako, he would just rouse up the crowd. She would rouse up the crowd. I would put you. So, I would put all the technical things just to put some credibility in what you were saying. So, and then part of this is that you want to expand the choices of the poor, human rights, you want to be able to provide one to be able to afford human rights and bring them more participation. Next slide. Okay, well, this is one of those things. You can see that actually we have gone through a rapid period of growth. Everybody is celebrating. Of course, now since the 2007-2008 crisis, people are not very sure, right? And one of the top patterns of why that growth happened is because labor change have been declining, and now people are talking about inequality. Again, you know, inequality and common but differentiated responsibility. Right? Are you going to force the poor to migrate because you cannot take care of providing them infrastructure and all that? Can you have the next slide? Okay, so I told me I'm not fine. This is one of my colleagues in the South Center. He's first, just to make an argument for his credibility. He was just elected vice president of, he's from Mali, vice president of the intergovernmental panel on climate change. So I thought, I got this graph from him. He said, basically, you cannot say that he's an NGO or I'm just making a joke. You cannot say that he's only worried about social development. He's an environmentalist, no? He was one of the chairs, the last time you came to AR5, he was one of the chairs of the mitigation. He was one of the three co-chairs of the mitigation. Now he was just elected vice president of the international intergovernmental panel on climate change. So basically what he's saying is there is still poverty and there are development aspirations. So basically, ending extreme poverty in all its forms comes from the SDG, not the SDG that the thing that I showed earlier. And basically, he's also saying you cannot have sustained growth unless you industrialize. You can always have sustained, you can always have good growth if the external economy is good. Right? But if you want to be a sustained growth, you have to be doing structural change in your own country. You cannot just say no. So what happened before is, what happened before was that there was a very strong liquidity that was made available to the global economy because the U.S. was running deficits. And then there was a crisis of 2007-2008. When that happened, the U.S. then pumped a lot of money, and so we were growing very well, not only us, but Brazil, many other countries. If you allow those things to happen to you, then you're not changing yourself, right? You're not changing your own structure in your own country, right? You're just taking advantage of it. So therefore, you have to industrialize in order to get growth. Full employment is one of the SDGs, it's SDG 8. No? So all this I call SDG 1. No? Can I have the next slide, please? I've already talked about this. Right? More or less, our problem is the developmental space, right? As I said, I'm not going to say anything new, but we're not sure whether our government will not betray us. So the question is, this is what is remaining? And between 1817 and 2011, 1900 has been used. This is like to keep atmospheric concentration below 450 parts per million. So in order to make sure that you don't have universal climate change. Can you have the next slide, please? And I'm going to be grasping. Sustainable development and poverty. And, this is an argument about 1992, right? In 1992, the reason why the global community invented the term sustainable development is because they were agreed at that time that poverty is one of the biggest polluters, one of the biggest emitters of pollution. Sustainable development means you have to solve poverty if you want to make sure that you save the planet. And this is a formulation at all, 1987 call for the Brundtland Commission. As I said, there's nothing new, no? The governments become lazy, they do play, they think that the market is going to solve it, but this is already in discussion before. Can you have the next slide? Alright, so this is again from my colleague, the Yuba Sopona. So he's saying, let's start with development priorities. So do you have these two competing, so, you know, there are environmentalists here, they will get angry too at that. But so if poverty and inequality are the causes of a lot of pollution, and in order to solve it, you have to solve poverty also everywhere, then you should have to provide the space to develop your land. So basically, you have to undertake developmental policies, but to make sure that you are very sensitive to the making of its climate decision and environmental policies, this is where technological innovation is required. And this is where, because you want to change the technology, right? You want to change the technology in agriculture, you want to change the technology at which you make buildings, which you have air conditioning. This is why you need industrial policy, at which you produce generators. So this is the idea, right? So companies like us have to figure out a way to do two things at the same time, to walk with 2 feet. One is to be sure that they do not, that they take up their responsibility in climate change. But in order to do that, they have to make sure that they're also changing the technology. They're changing the coefficient, going to 0.74, at which emissions are replaced by. Can we have the next slide, please? So then you have to worry about what are the barriers, right? The barriers include this one is what people like to talk about, people don't know. But for me, the biggest problem is really there has to be actual industrial development in the country, industrial planning, in a very detailed manner. And the reason why you need a very detailed manner is because whether you get it from ODA or you get it from some the Green Climate Fund, it is better that you have a detailed calculation so that you can justify external funding if you don't have their own capability to fund. I think I have a slide that comes later. Can you have the next slide? Okay, so you have to, of course, you have to build your capability to fund it yourself, the financial thing, climate proof investments. Can you have the next slide, please? Okay, a problema, first of all, if you want to fund climate change yourself, you have to make sure that you collect enough taxes, right? This is the age of the tax in 1980. People are saying this is tax in America, right? But this is an IMF graph, right? So we have to, a country like us, so you can say it in very stark terms. If you want to do climate change, the first thing you have to do is to be able to have enough taxes. In a country like ours that have a very high income inequality, the first thing you have to do is you have to tax the rich and to tax the corporations. Right? If you want to do climate change, right? Then also if you want to develop, right? Then you have the next slide, please. And this is actually the world countries. This is now a comparison of the Philippines, actually. So there's a IMF 2016 paper that shows that the Philippines actually investment rate is the proportion of the GDP that the country invests. Investment over GDP. Philippines is a very low investment rate. It's much lower than, of course, it's about the same as Latin America. Right? And if you want to change the technology, you have to increase the scale of your investment, which means also the advantage that you will grow faster, right? But we have to find a way to increase the rate of investment. Can I have the next slide? In comparison to ASEAN, our public investment is very low, right? Take Vietnam. Vietnam, so the public investment doesn't tend to do anything with how poor you are. As of now, Vietnam is still poorer than us, right? And the public investment rate is higher than ours. We have private sector, we have nice buildings. If you go to Vietnam, it's much more backward than us. But they have a very high rate of public investment. So it's a question of whether we are willing to do it. And actually, our problem is that there's an ideological issue that we should let the private sector do it. I was looking at the Sila Juan Joy shared with me yung energy plan in Pilipinas. All of it is, of course, private sector because of the PIRA, right? But private sector intentions of what the planned installed capacity is. In most other countries, this is a better to be a very strange table actually. Because in most other countries, the provision of energy supply would be in the first place a responsibility of government. And then the next slide has. After I have a few graphs about the public capital stock of the Philippines compared to Malaysia, in percent of GDP is much smaller. Right? And then the next slide, please. The quality of the I don't live here, but I don't know whether you agree with this, but compared to other ASEAN countries, it is much less, right? So these are the kinds of investments we have to undertake. For now, if you do this investment, the planned investments are called part plant, you know, and a lot of people are not called part plant and gas,
right? Natural gas.
Natural gas. So, if you take the next slide, please. The quality of our infrastructure, right? This overall quality is important. What they're doing is measuring it by some kind of a scale, 1 to 7. They have some kind of a survey, IMF. And ours is worse. Quality of the ports against ASEAN, not so good. Of course, now, the moment you say Mundalagay is important, then to convince the environmentalist, it's a good idea to put a port here. That, so can we have the next slide, please? So this is one example that I went through in my discussion about. Suppose you want to SDG six, Sustainable Development Goal 6 says we promise all the governments in the world to provide universal access to water, to clean water. And SDG 6.1 is a sub goal under the water. To achieve universal and equitable access to safe and affordable drinking water. The problem with water, unless you live in Switzerland, the water has to be pumped. No? And when you pump the water, you need more energy. Right? You have to find a way to put it. Of course, you also need a pipe. So, and you would also need the infrastructure. So this is the kind of investments that we are prepared to undertake. If you want to provide this, can I have the next slide, please? And talk. So what would you do, suppose if you said we will provide we need additional energy in order to provide water for everyone. But the first thing you would, this is an example of my calculation about how detailed we have to be, right? How detailed our planning has to be. And in a sense, it's the kind of thing that you would do in industrial policy. You would project what you need as an additional supply. You would cost how much it would be based on the cheapest available technology, called, let's say, coal-fired plant. You would cost how much it would be if it's a renewable kind of energy. You would see whether you can provide the clean energy on your own resources. Alam mo yun sa plano ng Ipira, meron pang waves, energy. Projections. To what extent, let's say, can we use more wave energy, right? And then if we cannot provide for all of it, the incremental cost we should apply for. We should apply for funding elsewhere in order to undertake the kind of energy development that you want. Can you have the next slide? Yeah, so this is the INDC. I showed you the INDC, right? Our contributions to climate change will depend on whether we get the resources. So we already said it, right? So if they don't give us the money, I'm sure the climate commission will get the idea. Let's put up a coal-fired plant, right? I mean, I know it's not just the commission will get angry, but even the people in the environmentalists here. But the argument I'm trying to say is let's first decide if we want to develop, we want to restructure our economy. And that we do very detailed planning, and if we need an incremental cost, we ask for external financing. Can I have the next slide? All right. So this is listed in the INDC. INDC is the intended nationally determined contributions to the climate change achievement. So we need to have technological development. Our market incentives are too weak because the existing technology is commercially profitable. Right. That's why. Yung mga plano ng private sector on the provision of energy are all coal-fired plants. And then we need this kind of regulation, carbon pricing, carbon regulation, taxes and subsidies. And you have the next slide. I don't know whether I should go to this. This is our installed capacity. Let me just make a comment. I said, this is what we have now. That is energy. Can I have the next slide, please? And after we came up projection, see, this is the other thing. Whether our energy planning has consulted with the Commission on.
First of all,
I'm just commenting, not even as a commission on climate change, but as just an economist. Pagkanda rin yung mga numbers na ito, ang liit niya, 100 megawatts additional every year. Now, in economics, we know that GDP growth and energy use are actually, well, no, they're almost one-to-one. No? The growth rate that the Philippines is planning is only 0.7, not even 1% per year.
So,
growth rate of additional capacity, maybe I'm misinterpreting the data, no, but that disappeared over the long run, I'm not going to tell you. We're only assuming the per capita growth rate of 1% per year. I mean, depending on your. Anyway, this is what's in the numbers. So can we have the next slide, please? Okay, I think that that's so. The last point is you need to integrate everything that you do, right? That you cannot integrate unless you promise you just wait for the private sector to respond to the price. You can change the prices, you can impose emission ceilings and all that stuff, right? But if you're really serious about being involved in climate change, there has to be a bigger, stronger government role in the economic life of the country. Thank you.